Thanks for coming. So before I start, just some words about myself and about Criteo. So Criteo is an ad company, and we will actually display ads on the internet. So when you browse the internet, we have trackers that register the data, and then at some place we display the ads on the internet. And about myself, I'm a software engineer in the engine prediction department, and working on the ML pipeline, and we are about 100 engineers working on ML-related stuff. So this includes the researchers that are searching new algorithms, the data scientists that are working on, on feature engineering, and the engineers like me that are working on the data science lab and to making this stuff scale to production. When I arrived in my team, I knew the math of the ML algorithms we use. But it turns out, actually, the ML-related stuff is only 10% of your code. So why is this the case? So what happens in general, you have a lot of ML algorithms. So what you just do, you include the library, and you just include an external library, and then you just call one line of code. And then, what you have to do around, and then you have all to do all the stuff around. So you have to build all the MLA pipeline around, you have to load your data, transform your data, save your data, you have to build the model lifecycle. You have to apply configuration, and it turns out it's really complicated. And also, actually, there's not so much standardized stuff out there. I just saw 5 days ago there was a new post from Databricks where they present ML Flow. But actually, it's quite new, and there's not so much standardized stuff out there. So what we have is actually in 2017, 2018, there were a lot of papers that came out from Google, Facebook, Uber, Airbnb on how to present their ML pipeline. And so I'm here today to present you how Criteo implements its ML pipeline. So first to start, we get 200 terabytes of data every day. So how do we get all this data? So actually, so as I said before, when you browse the internet, we have JavaScript trackers. So let's say you want to buy shoes. So you will look at your shoes, buy the shoes, and every time you create an event, it will be sent to our servers and will be saved on HDFS. And then when we display the ad to you, also you will eventually click on the ad. And so same thing, we will save the data on our servers. And the third data source we have is actually we don't have just the idea of the product, but we also import the data from our advertisers, from our... And so what we also know the size of the shoes you looked at, the color you looked at. So all this stuff is saved on HDFS, and it's 200 terabytes per day. We have Europe's largest Hadoop cluster with more than 3,000 nodes. And all this data is saved in our Hadoop cluster. And also what we do is we join this data together and create new data sets based on it, which we also save on our Hadoop cluster. So actually, when we display an ad, we pay if we want to display an ad, but we are paid when the user eventually clicks on the ad and buys the product. So it's in our real interest that, to only display the ad to users that will also buy and click on it. So it's a good use case for machine learning. So now what we can do is to build a model given all our data and try to predict if the user we know if we really click on the ad or not. So let's say we use logistic regression for this. I will come back to this later, why we don't use deep models yet. And let's say our use case is given the description of a user and an item history, build a model to predict how likely a user will be to click on the ad. And obviously, if he's quite likely, we will display the ad, he will click, and we are paid, so it will be beneficial for us. Seems quite easy. There's a lot of stuff. We have already the cluster, so we could just use Spark and mLib for this. And as we want to schedule the job somewhere, we also could use Yarn. So seems really easy. Let's just one thing about the offline and the online world. Actually, what we generally distinguish is two types of pipelines. So we distinguish the offline pipeline and the online pipeline. Offline actually is when we learn the model, and offline means actually that time is not really an issue. So we can do it by night, we read all the logs from HDFS, we launch batch processes, and if it takes some hours, it's not an issue. Then we build our model, and then we have to deploy it, and then we have to deploy it online, and then we come to the online world where we need, where we use our model to predict. And on the online world, it means it must be really, really fast. And when I mean fast, it's under 100 microseconds one prediction. So let's start with the offline learning, which is a batch process. So here are the essential steps of what we do for offline learning. So first we load the data from HDFS, then we have to apply feature transformation, then we do hashing. I will come to back to this later, why we do this. Then we apply our learning algorithm, and then we deploy our model for production. Well, we use actually Spark to do this. So who regular works with Spark? A lot of people, okay, nice, nice. So first thing, well, what we could just do is to launch one Spark job and one Spark application with multiple jobs. But actually, well, the thing is that our workload is quite different because the feature transformation step is what this basically is. It's just reading from HDFS and mapping the data and then just saving it somewhere. And actually, the training step is where we apply our learning algorithm. So we have multiple iterations. We have to get back our data to the driver. And then we have to road test again to the executors. So this means actually the training will consume much more memory. So that's why actually what we want to do is to tune our Spark jobs independently. So we want to give more memory and less parallelism to the training. And the feature transformation, we can just increase parallelism, launch a lot of tasks on the executor, and it will work quite well. So that's why we have two different Spark jobs. So let's start with feature transformations. Well, quite an important step in the ML pipeline. I let you read something I've extracted from the Google paper, ML Test Score. Okay, so it is quite important, actually. So it's really, really important that, well, if you have stuff to reuse on your pipelines for the offline and the online world, that you reuse the same code. So it's, otherwise, you will have issues. It will predict stuff that you have never seen before, and it's really, really complicated. So this is obviously, well, what we do, except with one complication, is we still use C#. And, well, so our Spark jobs, it will work on the GVM. But actually, in the online world, when we need to predict and to say and to decide if we bid for the ad, all our servers are running in C#. So we have somehow make cohabitate the two worlds that are not generally don't interact well with each other. Well, it turns out it's not so complicated either. So C# now it's working cross-platform. So well, we still use Mono, which is the cross-platform implementation of C#, and I guess in the future we will use .NET Core. So C# is working now on Linux. And so what we just do is we do it the Linux way. We just use Spark Pipe. So we just pipe, we just invoke the C# process. We pipe everything STD in using protocol serializations, and then we retrieve the result in STD out in a streamed way. Turns out it works quite well, and it really allows us to reuse all our feature transformation pipeline. Next thing about feature transformations, if you look at all the major ML challenges, actually, the people who won were people who were using ensemble methods. What this just means is that actually they're training many, many models, and then they just stack them together, and the result it will work at least as good as the best of the methods, but in general it works much better. So all people who win ML challenges win like this. So what does it mean in practice? In practice it means actually that you not only have your model, you not only have features, you not only have feature transformations, but also your model will depend on predictions of other models. So it means it can really, really become a complicated graph where your model depends on models and then other models again. What you should absolutely avoid is to have cycles in it. So you should somehow make sure to not, well, produce any cycles. And you also should make sure that you, well, really include this in your ML platform, that you handle the model lifecycle well, that you make sure that it's applied the same way. And that, well, actually what you have to do is you have to apply off engineering best practices to it. So you have to do code reviews, testing, integration tests, non-regression tests. It should also, very important thing is that it's reproducible. and that you can easily reapply this exactly same pipeline as before. So let's come to our hashing step. So, well, we have done all our feature transformations. This is done. Well, actually what we have is for one learning, our data set is about several terabytes big. And well, and one other thing is actually we have 8 billion modalities. So what does this mean? Well, let's take an example. So let's take, for example, just a learning with one feature, which is the users, the country where the user is coming from. So this would be the raw feature. And the specific value, for example, he's coming from Germany, from France, from Japan, would be one modality. So in this case, we would have three modalities. And in our case, actually, it's 8 billion. So it's really, really a lot of modalities and that we have. And well, you can't just reasonably run a model on this just with brute force and with a dense vector, actually. So you would have to save this in a dictionary, assigning indexes, and it would consume multiple gigabytes of data. So it's not possible to do this just like this. So actually, so who knows, one hot encoding? Okay. So let's come back to this again. So this is my example. Let's take an example. So I have, one line of this table is one training example. We just have one feature, which is the user's country. And the first user is from France, the second user is from Germany, the third user from Germany, and then there are many, many, many users. And then there's one user from Japan. So now we want to train an ML model on this. Well, we can't obviously just inject the modalities like this, so we have to convert it somehow. It only works with double values, so we have to convert it somehow. What we just could do is, well, just assign an index. So we say France is 1, Germany is 2, then we assign other indexes, and then Japan gets 100. Well, unfortunately, this doesn't work because, if you assign a continuous value, what you actually mean is that, what this actually means is that Germany is 2 times important, more important than France, and Japan would be 100 times more important than France. So it means that stuff that is next to each other would be related, and it obviously wouldn't work in this way. So what you generally do in this case, well, you can't just assign an index, so you use one hot encoding for this. So what you do is actually if you know the modalities, it's easy, but if you don't know, you have to do a first pass and to extract the modalities you have. So in my case, it's just 3. And then you create one column for each modality you have. And what you do is, well, that's why it's called one hot. When you see the modality, you just activate it by one. So in the first case, actually, the choice says I see France, so we just activate the France column, and everything else will be 0. In the second case, I see Germany, so I will activate the Germany column, everything else will be 0. And actually, you will have the number of columns will be equivalent to the number of modalities. So what does it mean in our case? That we will have 8 billion columns, actually. So it's not possible to handle this this feature vector like this. This is just a generalization. So for our countries, obviously, there are not so many countries in the world either. So you would have 200 columns, and you even know them before because the countries is fixed. But actually, we have features where we don't even know which modalities we see, and it would be many, many modalities. So. Well, so here you can see again that it's quite sparse. So out of the 200 columns, you will only have one at one point in time. So you have many, many, many zeros and a few ones. 8 billion columns, it would be very too much. So if you model this with a float, it would be multiple gigabytes of data. So what we just do is what we call the hashing trick. It actually, what it just means, we limit the number of columns, and that what we just do. What we just do is, when we see France, we compute a hash function, And then we just, so in this case, it would be one. And then we just activate the right the column that we have seen for France modality. So if we have another modality, for example, we have seen red shoes, it will compute the hash function on red shoes. It will give an index 4. And we will just activate this column. So obviously now, as our number of columns is not illimited, what we have to do is, well, we will get collisions. So for example, if the user used the Chrome browser, it will also compute hash 1. And it means, in this case, we can't distinguish anymore between France and Chrome browser. So what we do in practice is, well, we nevertheless choose the columns quite large. So instead of 8 billion, we take 68 million, which is 2 to the power of 26, just rounded. And well, it gets reasonable. It takes 256 megabytes in memory. So it means now one feature vector would be 256 megabytes. And if we use logistic regression, it means that also our feature vector would be 256 megabytes, actually. So hashing is done. We have trimmed down all other modalities to reasonable size. It's still large, so that's why we do it on Spark and we do it in a distributed way. So let's come to our training phase. Well, so why? Well, you have seen that it's very, very sparse. So in our case, actually, on the 8 billion modalities at one point in time, we only would have 200 runs. So it's really, really few. And so that's why we don't use a default implementation, so we don't use mlib, because we want to exploit the sparsity of our feature vector. Otherwise, it wouldn't scale in a reasonable way. So that's why we have our own implementation of logistic regression. So why do we still use logistic regression, and why not deep learning, which is, the reason is, well, actually, it's working quite well for our use case. So it's working quite well with our feature space. We have only categories, same thing, it works quite well. And actually also our online use case where we have to predict really fast, well, it works best with logistic regression where you just have to apply your feature vector and then your weight matrix, you just compute a scalar product. So in our case, it would just be 200 multiplications and then just apply the sigmoid function and you have predicted. And well, and this, so that's why actually we use it, and because it's so fast and we need to have it very fast. And on deep learning stuff, you have to compute multiple layers and there's a lot of research currently going on to move to better models, deep learning models and so on, but it's, well, it would be the work for the next few years, I think. So logistic regression, I won't go into mass details as this is about engineering part. Just some words about logistic regression and what we do in an intuitive way and how we, but and then we'll focus on how we engineer this. So what we actually do is we compute a loss function which determines the difference between your label, so if you clicked or not, and the output of your model. And what you want to do is to find the best weights that you predict best and you fit best your label. And so this generally is a convex function. It has a global minimum. And so it means we can just solve this with gradient descent. So we just assign the weights somewhere. And then we compute the gradient, apply it to the weights. And then we do this, and this is called one iteration. And then we just continue until we converge to a global minimum. So how can we modelize this in Spark? Well, this would be one, obviously our data is on HDFS, so it's already partitioned. So what we just have to do actually, how can we distribute? Well, first maybe just step back and how can we distribute this computation? So actually what we just have to do is, well, we just split our data set in chunks, compute the gradient on each chunk, and then we just have to add our gradients back, send them back to the driver, apply them to our weights, and then broadcast them back again to the executor and start again. And this we do until actually our weights don't change anymore. And in this case, we have found the best weights for our model. So let's focus on one step. So inside one this would be one Spark task actually. And so what we just have to do is to do map partitions, then we loop on each data line, we compute the sparse gradient, and then just we apply this back into a gradient accumulator. And what we now can just do is, here you see the partitions for each task. And what, so this will give us a 256 megabyte gradient. And what we just can do now is to do reduce and bring all our stuff back to the driver. So obviously it wouldn't work because we don't have just four partitions, we have 8,000. So 8,000 times 256 megabyte, you would have to send all this stuff back to the driver. So a lot of, it would be a lot of network traffic. And also you can't scale in the cluster, so your driver would just compute this in a linear way. It would take a long time. Maybe not that long, but it's not obvious, well, not the best solution. So next best solution would be to use tree reduce. So tree reduce, what you just do is, instead of doing all the accumulation in the driver, what you just do is you split this up in multiple steps. So you will have one executor that is reducing a part of your arrays, another executor that is reducing part of your arrays. And the default, if you don't use any default, it would be two, so two steps of reduction. And in our case, for 8,000 partitions, would mean that we at one point in time, we had to reduce 90 partitions. Still not very performant, so 90 times 256 megabyte. So to make this work, we would really have to increase the depth of tree reduce. So if we increase it to 5, it would mean at one point in time, we have to reduce 6 partitions. But obviously, tree reduce in the back, it's implemented with, it will produce shuffling at every layer. So it means that at every layer, we'll have a shuffling step. And shuffling in Spark, it's slow. So you shouldn't do, it means that it will be really, really slow. So how can we do this better? So actually, in our case, the 256 megabytes is our weights. And we don't care to reduce the 256 megabytes array just everything. So what we actually want to do is to take one column of the weights and just aggregate it. So what we do is we split this in small chunks of 4 megabytes. And by just using flat map and assigning a key to each chunk of 4 megabytes. And what we now just have to do is reduce by key. So, you reduce by key, it will produce the shuffling, accumulating all our stuff in each chunk. And then we just do collect, get it back to the driver, and just have to accumulate our 256 megabyte gradient array again. So better, much better, it's working nicely. We release this to production. But, we had nevertheless a lot of out-of-memory errors. So it was kind of working because you have the default fallback in Spark, which is that, by default, it's retrying a task 3 times. So that's why sometimes often it was working, but often it was not working. So out of memory errors. So we started investigating this. And it turns out, there was one place left where we had the 256 megabyte array and was inside one task. So inside one task, we still had the 256 megabyte gradient accumulator. It's really in one task on one executor. And then we investigated and actually, what we were doing, we had 12, each executor had 12 gigabytes of heap and we were running a 12 task on each executor and they are all sharing the same GVM. 256 times 12, it's around 3 gigabyte. So we didn't really understand why we would have out of memory exceptions. So then started multiple weeks of investigation. it was actually quite complicated. So we activated Spark metrics everywhere. Every day somebody was coming up with a new theory on what could actually happen. Then we had other issues that were not related to this. I won't go into detail, which were actually when it was killed by yarn and not out of heap. When we understood that, we really didn't have any heap space left, what we did is to activate, we were using G1GC, by the way, which is also was in our case the reason of our errors. And if we had used another garbage collector, it would have worked. So basically, we just activated everything we could. And what we did actually is, what you have is in the Spark options, you have extra Java options. You could just add all this stuff and it will put your stuff to the Spark logs or in the Yarn logs if you use Yarn. And just have to get back your file and look at it. So in our case, what happened is actually, this is the right side on the right side is our heap on G1 GC, and one region, one block in this part is actually one region of G1. It's the way G1 GC handles the heap. Well, one block is one region of G1 GC, which by default is 4 megabytes. And all the taken stuff, well, will be G1 GC that is putting your stuff into the old or the new generation, and it will also compact on it. But actually, if your object is larger than 4 megabytes, it will be handled specifically, and it will be handled as a humongous object. And what this just means is actually that it will be directly assigned to the old generation, and also that it won't be compacted. So it will be just assigned somewhere in memory, and then it won't be compacted. And so in our case, as we had many humongous objects assigned, actually there was really no free space, continuous free space left in our memory to assign. So how to get out of this? So, well, we could change the garbage collector, we could change the region size. Well, most often, it's not a technology that it's erroneous. Well, we have to change how we use it. So we have to get rid of the 256 megabyte array, actually, and find a better way. So in our case, actually, so the data lane, they are always sparse. So in general, there's only 200 values out of the 8 billion values that are set. But generally, what is dense is the weights, because when you compute your model on all your data lanes, so, well, it will fill up your weights. It turns out, actually, on one specific task, as you don't process the full data set, well, your weights will still stay sparse. So as you only compute like 10,000 lines, the gradients are still sparse. So what we just did is to replace this with a hash map. And if it would be dense, it wouldn't work because the hash map would take even more memory than just an array. But as it still stays sparse in one executor, it works actually. So much better now, everything is sparse. We get it back to the driver, we can compute multiple iterations. So now we have one Spark learning that is working, which will compute our probability if the user's clicking on the ad. So how can we learn thousands of models? Well, first thing maybe to answer, so why do we need to compute thousands of models? Well, the answer is, we don't only have the peak model, we also have many different business models. We also modelize if the user will be buying an ad, we have fraud analysis models, and we have many different models. And also, as I have explained before, like the stacking ensemble methods will produce that you have to accumulate multiple models. And another reason is actually, as we use logistic regression, your model will really, really lose accuracy over time. So it means that you have to train it very, very often. And very often means, every hours or something. So in average, well, this broad model, we relearn it every 3 hours in production. And so one other thing is, so now we have to learn thousands of models. And we use Yarn to schedule it, but actually, we don't just want to, Yarn just uses resource consumption. So you say how much CPU you want, how much memory you want, and you can assign some quotas for your user. And then it will be just scheduled if you have play time. But what we actually want is, for example, if the model fails, we want to relearn it instantly and not just the other thousands of models have passed. So we want to have our custom built business policy for scheduling. So that's why actually we have our custom scheduler that is on top of Yarn and that we run in a Mesos cluster. And we implement some business rules on which model to train first. And so now we have to learn thousands of models. So this again is our pipeline. So we have to prepare some config. We can launch our Spark process, our Spark preprocess, our Spark learning, and then deploy our model. But if you just put this in a Mesos container and you just train thousands of models at the same time, it wouldn't work because it will assign memory. And even if you have 1 gigabyte of memory for each training, if you times thousands, so you will run out of memory. So what we do is we use the concept of Yarn Application Master. So actually, this is an existing concept of Yarn. And so we just scale our learning inside in Yarn Application Master. And that means our scheduler doesn't do much stuff. It will just launch the learning, monitor the stuff, and then, well, kill learning if it runs too long, or schedule new learnings, actually. And so just for completeness, so you launch your Learn Application Master, it will launch the different steps, and then each Spark job will have its own application master and its own executors with the task. Last step of your offline pipeline is deployment. Well, so we learn all the stuff in one. We have our own data centers, so we don't use the cloud. And so we have data centers in the US, in Europe, and in Asia. And so the learnings happens on our Hadoop cluster in Paris. And so what we just do, we copy it. Well, we still use FTP, which is old school, but it's working quite well. So we learn our model, we package it to a zip file, and then we copy it to all our FTP servers in the world. And well, and then are deployed, and then our online servers will download these models and will use them for serving. And well, all these FTP servers, they are gigabyte Ethernet because it has to be fast. So that was our offline pipeline. So now our online pipeline. Well, as I said, it must be really fast. Well, the one other reason why it must be fast is actually when you on your online, well, online is actually when you'd want to display an ad. It works in form of an auction, actually. So there are a lot of actors, and then the guy who makes the auction will ask, do you want to display the ad? Do you want to display the ad? And if you don't respond in time, you never can win the ad, actually. So it, I guess the limit is like maybe 10 milliseconds. I don't even know exactly. But in any case, as we want to apply multiple models and so on, well, it makes that we have to be under 100 microseconds for one prediction. So this is our online pipeline. So you just see, well, the same, well, so it's working on C# on Windows, this all this stuff. So feature transformation hashing, we can just reuse it. It works as is because it's the same code. Obviously now we do the prediction, so we don't learn on the full terabyte dataset. So it's just one feature vector, and it will be actually just 200 one-hot columns that are active. Then we do our prediction. So now we really benefit from our logistic regression model because the prediction, it's only actually just applying the feature vector, doing the scalar of products with your weights. So we have 200 multiplications and then just apply sigmoid function and you predict it and you get a probability. And well, the model, it won't be just loaded synchronously. So we will refresh it asynchronously and download it from the FTP, store it in cache and then use it in, well, just in memory to predict. And this prediction, nevertheless, it includes the whole pipeline. So all the stacking, it will apply the dependent predictions of dependent models and so on. So it's not just one scalar product, but multiple scalar products, but nevertheless, it works quite well. So this allows us, well, we have several thousand servers to do 10 million predictions per second, but distributed on several thousand servers. And well, I'm nearly done. Maybe just, well, such that we have time for questions and answers. Just one last slide. So prediction is done, offline learning is done. How do we monitor all this stuff? Well, actually, we just combine a stack of open source tools. So it's, well, we just use, well, we configure a stack of a bunch of open source tools. So we use Mesos for our business scheduler, which will run all the learnings. Then we use Finatra, which is HTTP, with Twitter's HTTP REST API to expose a bunch of metrics. And well, then we use Prometheus, which is an alerting and monitoring system, which will scrape the metrics from our production scheduler. So then we have a bunch of alerts on this if something is wrong. For long-term storage, then we save all the stuff in Graphite. And then we have several, well, at least 20 Grafana boards to monitor all the stuff and to plug. And if something is wrong, the number of waiting tasks, the number of learning tasks. And well, and for the logging, we just use the Elastic, well, keep on our Elasticsearch stack. We don't lose log stash. So we just have our process that is, well, putting this to Elasticsearch and then a bunch of Kibana boards to access the logs if something is wrong. Well, that's all I have to tell you. So,
thank you very much. So I have a question about Your training with sparse coefficients, so you at the end said that gradients are still sparse. So just want to understand your pipeline. Maybe can you walk through this again? So.
The Spark process or just the boxes? This?
Yeah. So you do map partition first or?
Well,
how does it work?
Well, you just have on one partition you have multiple lines each line is one example. What you just have to do is a flat map where you split your full array into blocks, and to each block you assign an index. So to find it back after that. So the first 4 megabytes will get index 0, second 4 megabytes index 1, until you end up at the end. And then as you have transformed your data set in key value pairs, you just do reduce by key and you just do plus of your arrays. So you have a 4 megabyte array, and then you just will add each individual value and everything else will be handled by Spark.
This is what didn't work for you, right? So you ended up implementing it with HashMap?
No. There are two steps actually. There's the step where you have your executors and you have to get all your stuff back to the driver. This is this step. And then what you also have to do is inside one task, well, you have also multiple lines and you have to accumulate an inside one Spark task actually. There are two things. Actually, this is when you have to get back all the stuff to the driver. So you transformed your okay, then. So
first you compute gradients for each partition using map partition, right?
Yes, that means that inside this. Okay, and this step is the step where it out of memory arrows actually, and so this is the step where you compute, you loop on all the line on one line, and you have maybe 10,000 inside one partition, inside one Spark task. Then you get a result, which is a gradient as well, and then you just have just to get back everything to your driver. So you just have to add all these arrays back. This is inside the cluster. Everything is inside the cluster. Then you have to get it back somehow in the driver. So what you just do, well, you compute your final array, then you assign a key, and then when you do reduce by key and collect, reduce by key will do the shuffle in the cluster as well. But what you have now is a key and a 4 megabyte array inside the cluster. Then we just do collect. It will just collect everything back to the driver. But as it's already reduced, it's an issue as here where you have to send everything. So we will just send back, just 256 megabytes actually. So 4 megabyte for this key, 4 megabyte for this key. And then it's just accumulated back again into, I don't know if it's clearer.
So what is not clear, what you said, that it actually didn't work, and then at the end you needed to replace it with a hash map. But so what I wanted to ask is, like, this hash map at the end, like when you do this all reduced by key, doesn't it become dense?
Yes.
And
yes,
then you just replace it with array?
No, it becomes dense, but, when you are here, it's dense.
Okay.
But, well, this stuff, it's inside one executor, inside one task, actually.
It's the array that is sparse, but when you make it into a hash map, it becomes dense, and so it takes in less space, and you can actually bring it to the driver, right?
No, but it becomes dense only when you accumulate everything back together, actually.
Right.
Okay. It's one line is sparse. If you accumulate the gradient on 10 lines, it's still sparse. But if you accumulate the gradient on 10,000 or 2 terabytes, it will get dense. But so it means that, well, inside one task, you only process, like, say, let's say 10 lines. You compute the final gradient. And then what you have to do is to get this back to the driver on each of your partitions. And then that's where we do reduce by key, actually. Well, basically, what we just do is we remove the 256 megabyte array everywhere. It's just, well, except that it wasn't one, we didn't do this in, it took several weeks or months, because it's quite complicated, nevertheless, to arrive at the final, well.
Okay, we have time for one more question. He was raising his hand.
So you said your model update frequency is 3 hours. Yes. And I could imagine you would strive for even less because new creatives can come up. And did you use some? Do you use some kind of warm start training, or do you reprocess everything?
Yes, I didn't talk about it. We use model seeding. So as we retrain every time, we seed with the previous model, and obviously it will reduce the iterations. Yeah. So we just seed with random values. We seed with the previous model.
Okay.
So we just retrain from scratch the first time, and then every time we retrain, we seed with the previous model. Obviously, well, it's an easy optimization. Yeah.
And
there are other stuff. Advanced optimization techniques that are implemented. As we have our own implementation, there's other stuff that is optimized inside our training to make it faster.
Okay, thank you.
So thank you for coming. Another round of applause for Fabian.